You're on. You're live now.
Okay.
On one of his records.
Somebody's talking.
And he had, you know, we had the big mic hanging down. Just him and I.
You hear that?
I do. Do you hear it?
Yeah, but I don't know what it is.
So you hear that? The long and winding road that leads to your door will never disappear.
You're okay. Yay!
Well, kind of out of sync. I guess that's the going through the Zoom and all that. It gets.
Are you watching? What are you watching?
Just that.
Yeah, it's not out of sync when people see it on Facebook and YouTube. Yeah.
Hi, everybody.
Rosemary Butler is my honorable guest today. I'm blown away with what you have done in your life. And I love talking to people such as yourself who have had such a tremendous amount of experiences that are incredible. You know? I mean, I've had a full life and I'm happy with what I've done and I've experienced a lot, but there's something totally different about what you've experienced. You know, you've been on stage and in the studio with all these people who have made the biggest effect on the planet. You know, it's kind of mind blowing.
I was very, very fortunate, you know, and it all kind of started. I was in an all girl band playing bass, and we were signed, and we went to Europe, and we opened for BB King and Three Dog Night, and you know, we were doing some concerts around and stuff. And I met Bonnie Raitt. She was my door opener and mentor, and I sang with her and recorded with her. And then she introduced me to Jackson Browne. Jackson Browne was recording, I guess, a Pretender or something. And you know, he was very sad because his wife had committed suicide. Oh. And he was very alone and everything. And she goes, "Why don't you call him up and say, I told you to call him and you know, introduce yourself or something." And I went, okay. I mean, I really didn't know what was going on because I had been on the road.
Yeah.
I mean, Jackson Browne
David Oxenden,
one of the most amazing songwriters that was ever born.
Yeah.
His lyrics are just, they're just master paintings. So anyway, I called him and I said, you know, oh, so if you're recording and it's 4 o'clock in the morning and you're putting on a tambourine part, why don't you call me and I'll clap? So he did. He said, come on over. And I went, oh, okay. So I jumped over there and I got the tour. And it was very sweet. It was very just the thrill of a lifetime. We had the Warner Brothers jet.
Oh, geez.
We were going all around Europe, and we'd wake up in one country, do a gig, fly to the next one, do a gig, fly to the next one, do a gig. It was like every day we were on that jet and a private airline and everything. And one of the stories that I like to tell, because it's so amazing, it's like,
did that really happen?
we were going by Switzerland, and we were, you know, the jet, and every day you see all the jet flyers and stuff, and they pulled two jets came on either side of our jet, and they were talking to Jackson. They were going, "Hey, man, they're running on empty and no nukes and everything." So what is something that's gonna blow your mind? He went, "Wow, okay, yeah, we're in for it, you know." So they guide us, you know, through the air right past this giant mountain.
Wow.
And I swear to God this happened. Okay, because it's so movie like. And all of a sudden the top of the mountain went like this, and two jets came out.
And there you go. And it's not really sci-fi, is it?
No, it was
wow.
We were just like, whoa. But, you know, we did some, you know, grassroots stuff too with Jackson. We were really in, really into the no nuke thing. I don't know if you ever saw No Nukes, but it was, you know.
I never saw it, but that was in like the 70s, right?
Maybe.
Yeah.
I'm not very good because time is.
Because there were so many things.
Something like that.
Yeah.
And so we went around, you know, in a bus around the United States and stayed at Holiday Inns in the beginning, and went to the nuclear power plants around the country and where they had the nuclear warheads and everything. And there was like a grassroots group of people who were, you know, waiting for us and made little sandwiches for us and stuff. And it was very sweet. You know what I mean? It was like, it was very, very dear. And we had the Indians with us, American Indians.
Huh.
They love Mother Earth and don't want all of that stuff.
Yeah.
Jackson became a blood brother. And so it was like a different kind of tour than the other one.
Right. The bus and the plane, yeah, kind of different.
Very, very different. But it was like you got to know these people and how passionate they were.
Yeah.
Because some of those nuclear power plants, I guess, are still active, but most of them are not now.
Yeah.
It's time for that to happen.
Yeah.
And a couple of really bad explosions.
I had a very dear friend who was a nuclear engineer. He would tell me things. Some things were scary and some things were actually comforting. I think that people blew up to be something more dangerous, than they were actually. And so, that was still, it's just like, you just worry about that stuff. It's so worrisome.
Every time there's an earthquake, I'm like, oh shoot. Cause I know where they all are.
Right.
In the middle of the city and you're like, what?
Yeah.
Like UCLA's got them.
Really? Wow.
Teach them somewhere,
Wow.
A lot of them are on fault lines. I don't know.
That stuff has to be buried too. It has to be buried somewhere, and that's where it gets a little weird. It's like, I don't know. Oh my God. It's just, this opens up a huge Pandora's box, we don't have to go into that. But, it's just when you start thinking about it, like you said, Mother Earth and, that we're as a species, we're not really doing the ethical and, upwards health, solving and healing kind of stuff as a species. You and I are doing our parts, but adding.
And there's a lot of people trying.
Yeah.
You just have to cut through the red tape. But we once played at an Indian reservation at the Black Hills of South Dakota. Talk about a gig. Okay. It had been raining for like 3 days. We get there and all these Indians are sitting on, a little, blanket that they had made themselves in the dirt, and it had been raining and they had nothing over their head. And they were just smoking the peace pipe and, praying and stuff. And because in the Black Hills of South Dakota is where these Indians' relatives were buried, and the government wanted to dig it up and get uranium, and plutonium and stuff, and they were not happy. If you ever meet a happy, an unhappy group of Indians, it's a little scary. Like, whoa. And it was Bonnie Raitt and Graham Nash and Jackson and the band. And so we're there and we play a couple songs, and Jackson does this song called For a Dancer. And I don't sing on that one, so I ran out into the crowd and just wanted to be next to them and stuff, and was watching him on stage. And there was a row of dancers that were in a line, and they were doing the Sacred Eagle dance and all these, things, but they weren't performing for the crowd and they weren't performing for us on stage. They were performing for the full moon. I just went, whoa, this is wild. And so anyway, we had to stop. It was just like a little trailer, and all of us kind of got into this little tiny trailer, and we're like, oh, what's going to happen next? And it was raining, and so you saw them form a circle, and then there was this one group of Indians, the Rainbow Indians, and they were like, oh, doing all this sort of stuff, and we're like, yeah. intense. And he told us that, you know, we were on, anyway, so they said
you were on sacred property or something, or
something. Yeah. And so then we, it stopped raining. And it was like a miracle.
The moon.
You know, and so we were like, wow. We came out and there were seven rainbows.
Oh my God.
That went around the circle.
Wow.
It was so incredible. It was like, wow, that's the real stuff.
Wow.
Anything, you know. Okay. One time I was backstage at, where was it? Was it the Forum or something? I can't remember. A huge concert. And there's an Indian teepee with three Indian chiefs, their feathers and everything, smoking a peace pipe. And I went, hey, how you guys doing? You know, because I'd seen him every day on the tour. Anyway, we want to take you back to your ancestors. And I went, you do? You know, and I took a sip, you know, a little toke, and I realized, oh my God, I'm supposed to be on stage singing harmony with Phoebe. Phoebe, no. And I was like, I just couldn't put it together, you know. Standing on shaky ground and the Indians.
What happened?
Well, I missed the first chorus, but I made the second one.
Oh my God.
But they're like things that you just go, okay. Whatever. There was a place we played at Argo Sante, which is like, it, in those days, it was like a fully, you know, sun, water, you know, grow your own food, self-sustaining little town, and everybody worked. And so we did a benefit for them. And in those days, you know, this was an outdoor thing that they put together. You know, here's the stage and put a little fence around it. And da, 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 da. So, you know, made us little sandwiches and not thinking anything of it. And, you know, the truck drivers are going by on the freeway and they're talking through our amps, you know. Because we were working with No Nukes and stuff, there were a lot of rednecks that were not happy about that.
Oh. You know?
And so anyway, we dealt with that. And then the section, which was the group that backed up Jackson, but also did an opening set for them. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Came out and was doing their show. And the guy who was like, focusing the lights and stuff, realized that there was like a hill in the audience.
Yeah.
And on top of the hill were two guys with shotguns. And so he focused all the lights on them. And we were like, oh, we're on next. Oh, I can't wait. You know? Because they're there. You know, I mean, this is like the Wild West or something. There's nobody checking your purse. There's nobody.
Yeah.
Yeah, this or that. And then they start crawling over the fences.
Yeah.
It was just chaos. And the police came and they surrounded.
Wait, who started crawling over the fences? The audience or?
The audiences that didn't have a ticket.
Oh, I see.
It was like, you know. Just,
is that why the guys with the guns were there? Did you ever find out?
I never talked to them, but I sort of put them in the category of they didn't like No Nukes.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
You know,
so, oh, first of all, I just want to tell you that Deborah's here. She said hi. And Arto Sarla from Helsinki, he says hi.
Hi, Helsinki.
Neil Rosengarten, I don't know if you know him, and then several friends of mine, Dan Davila, and et cetera, Roland Askaroons. But so how long were you with Jackson Browne?
Years and years. I'm not sure, maybe 6 years or something.
Okay. So there was a lot of great, lot of great experiences with him.
Yeah, incredible. You want to hear more of that? I was on the road with Linda Ronstadt.
Okay.
And those were fun too. And Bonnie Raitt. Yeah. I have a good Bonnie Raitt story.
I love Bonnie Raitt. Bonnie Raitt, when I was in my 19 or 20, I was in Boston and Bonnie was there a lot. I don't know if she lived there, but she was always playing in Boston and Little Feet. So Boston was a real hodgepodge of music at that time. It was the early 70s and it was really, oh God, that stuff always just got into my soul and stayed there.
Yeah. Okay, so my story for Bonnie. I mean, there's lots of them.
Sure.
But this one is kind of like, what? We were in Russia.
Yeah.
Which was unusual for those days. Not a lot of tourists go there. Or went there. Anyway, so it was Santana and James Taylor and brothers? Bonnie. Anyway, so being the only two girls, we thought we'd go for a walk. Our hotel was, you know, you open the curtains and you see a nuclear power plant. We're like,
talking about nuclear power plants.
Okay. And every meal they thought, oh, well, Americans like hot dogs, right? So we breakfast, lunch, and dinner with hot dogs. It was like no vegetables or fruits or bread or nothing. It was like hilarious. So anyway, we go for a walk, and we don't know where the hell we are, right? We have no clue. We're just walking through this forest, and we look around, and there's some KGB guys following us. Well, this could be it. You know, they never found us, and they never knew what happened.
Oh, God.
And found a train station, and I was just really shaking because I thought this is like too scary for me. And she goes, okay, take out all the change in your purse or your pocket or whatever. We're gonna put them on the rails, and when the train comes, it'll flatten them out, and then you'll have a souvenir and you can talk about this story. I was like,
oh, that's really old school, man.
It's old school. So anyway, we lost them. We couldn't find them. They couldn't find us with all the people getting on the train. And we ran away. We didn't know where we were going, of course, but we end up at the Kremlin. And there were people that were walking across, you know, they walked across the United States.
Oh, yeah, I saw that in your film.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And they walked across Russia.
Yeah.
So yeah. They had to be standing in a circle holding hands, and all these, you know, soldiers were goose-stepping around them. And so I was like, we don't want to go here, do we, Bonnie? And she's like, oh, we have to show support. Come on, let's go. You know, we're singing some peace song or something, and I'm going, well, that was the end of my life, so yeah. The rest of my life in jail in Russia. Okay. But we're just singing a song. But anyway, it was like, you know, oh, scary. So anyway, it was fun times, just like wild times where you just go, what am I doing here? How did I get here? You know, but wonderful, sweet, loving times that he played for.
Let me ask you a question. So what was your perspective throughout some of this? Was it just like, hey, let's get the job done and have fun? Or was there something deeper that you were thinking or kind of in awe or whatever?
Just
What'd you say?
Oh, I'm blonde. I occasionally have a deep thought. yeah, I mean, it was, well, I would go from one tour to the next tour to the next tour to the next tour.
Yeah.
I worked with Roseanne Cash and got to go through all the country stuff, you know, the rodeos and, you know, we would, because of Johnny Cash, we would get like cowboy hats and belt buckles and boots and all kinds of stuff.
Yeah.
And Roseanne was kind of crossing the line between country there and rock, and she had purple hair and they were, oh, you know. But it was fun. It was fun. You meet a lot of interesting folk.
Yeah.
I ended up doing a lot of sessions over there too.
Uh-huh.
I loved doing that. That was really different. I remember I did a session for Dolly Parton's wig company. Commercial. She goes, "Now girls, I know who I am and I know who my audience is. They live in a trailer park. So don't sing it too perfect, okay?"
Oh God, that's funny. That's very funny. Well, I saw in your thing that you also worked a lot with that wonderful backup singer, the tall black man who did like James Taylor. What is his name?
Arnold McCullough.
Yeah, thank you. Arnold McCullough. And I saw, actually, speaking of doing a show at Vitello's, I saw him do one of his shows at Vitello's. He's what a wonderful singer.
Oh yeah. Yeah. He's doing a Johnny Mathis collection song.
Oh really?
Yeah. We actually sang with Johnny Mathis once on a Christmas special. Neil Diamond was going, "Christmas special? What am I doing here?" You know. But we were like pretending to put stuff on the tree while he was singing. It was
I saw you and then the clip, I saw you and Arnold kind of looking at Johnny and laughing. Obviously you were playing your parts, but
that was the first record I ever bought.
Johnny Mathis, yeah.
What a voice.
Yeah, I know.
You know, you could just fall in love in 2 seconds, you know.
Yeah. Speaking of growing up, so where did you grow up?
I was born in Providence, Rhode Island.
Providence, Rhode Island. I was born in Boston. So.
Oh, okay.
Neighbors, yeah. Providence, Rhode Island, yeah.
Yeah, and my dad was in the Army.
Oh.
This perfect, you know, training for someone who's going to be on the road most of their life.
Yeah.
Went across the United States 4 times before I went to first grade.
Oh wow!
Back. And yeah, I really did believe that there were jackalopes. Do you know what they are? If you're a kid, it's like a picture of a bunny, but it has antelope horns, and they all that at the gas station. And then they had pictures of like people carrying a gigantic furry fish inside of a truck. You know, I believe that was what was happening.
Why wouldn't you?
I mean, so I was always the new girl.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. And so you were the new girl, and that was up to first grade, and then did you guys settle down for a minute?
Yeah, we did. We went to the same school for 6 years. And,
6 years, wow.
4 years. And then my dad stopped doing all that.
Yeah.
My mom was from New Zealand.
Oh.
And I got to take her back and see everybody.
Cool.
So lovely. What a beautiful.
Were they musical, your parents?
On Saturdays, my dad, when my mom was doing the grocery shopping, he loved to sing love songs.
Oh.
But not professionally.
Yeah.
My mom loved musicals. And she loved to sing just for the joy of it, you know?
Yeah.
But my grandmother, my mother's mother, and my uncle in New Zealand, both were vocal coaches and had choirs and taught music and reading music and all that stuff. But I never met my grandmother, but I just send me little letters, you know, this is a staff and this is, these are notes, you know.
That's cool.
And I did meet my uncle, and he had a choir of Maoris.
Wow.
And, you know, it was really beautiful because New Zealand, you can drive to the coast from any point within a couple hours.
Yeah.
So, you know.
Yeah.
So beautiful.
Gorgeous. Yeah. And so you it sounds like you had no siblings.
Oh, no. I had a lot of siblings. Oh. I had an older brother, and I was second, and then a younger brother and a younger sister. And then like 12 years went by, and two more were born.
Oh, my gosh. Wow. 12 years.
Those were kind of like the babies I had.
Yeah. So were you all singing together? How did you get into singing? Where did you get inspired first?
I was always singing. I think I could sing before I could talk.
Yeah.
I was just make up melodies and stuff. It's easier. You don't have to know what you're saying. But I remember the first time I performed, I was with my Brownie troupe. We went to Disneyland. And you know, I was like just completely blown away. It was the first year that Disneyland came out, and the announcer goes, "Oh, is there anybody here who wants to sing a song?"
I do.
I sang, and I realized it was being broadcast like the radio all over Disneyland, and I thought,
"Oh my God!
Wow, I wonder if Mickey and never heard it, you know."
Wow.
I had a taste of, you know, that.
Right.
Also, when I was born in Providence, you know, I used to, they had the circus go by.
Yeah.
Because the circus was in town, so they would parade through the streets with the animals, you know, the camels and the giraffes and and all that, and the ladies would have those big feathers on and all these outrageous outfits, and I'd go, that's what I want to do. I want to do that.
And so, and you said when you first heard Johnny Mathis, you kind of died, but was there other people that really struck a chord in you when you were coming up?
Oh, sure, of course. When I was in high school, I was in an all-girl band, and we were playing concerts and stuff, recording, and independent. Our manager got us booked opening for the Rolling Stones on their first American tour.
Oh my God.
Same night as our prom, so I didn't get to go to prom.
Wow, what a choice. What a choice. Oh my God.
And I knew my life would be different from then on. Anyway,
wow, interesting.
So they came to our room, knocked on the door and stuff, and you know, we're just like virgins, you know, we don't do that kind of thing. You know, I mean, just like really innocent from high school. We wouldn't let them in. We had like flannel nightgowns on and rollers in our hair, and we're like, you know, and they're like, and they smoked some cigarettes, and after they left, I picked them all up. And the next day, when all the girls were at, you know, showing the picture of the prom, oh, this is my prom dress and my corsage, and this is, what's his name? Oh, yeah. And then, you want a cigarette to buy for Mick, touch Mick Jagger's lips.
And thus it began. That's funny.
Yep, that was different.
That's very funny.
They rushed the stage. They came in, it was in Bakersfield. They came on, you know, in those days you didn't sit or stand on the floor. You had to be in your seat. So they came in a Brinks armored truck. And they got up on stage. I think this must have happened a bunch of times. Anyway, so they got up on stage and they were playing. And when they did, this could be the last time the audience went insane. I mean, insane. And they ran across the dirt. And they were jumping on the stones and grabbing their hair and grabbing their guitars. It was very violent, you know. And I'm under the stage like this going, oh, my God. I didn't know what to do because there's no, you know, when it's in the round, there's no place to run. You know, there's no place to run. And so that was my prom night.
Wow. I'm assuming it worked out okay.
Well, once the Stones got in the Brinks armored truck.
I see.
But, I mean, they probably
Brinks got hurt. Armored truck. Is that, boy, that's interesting.
Yeah. I mean, they were so electric. They just completely drove them to a frenzy.
That's really wild. This guy from Finland, Arto, he said he has a fond memory of attending the JB Running on Empty Tour at the Concord Pavilion.
Nice. I have a fond memory too of Finland. We went to Finland, and I mean, it's beautiful there. I used to have a boyfriend who, my first boyfriend,
who
from Finland.
Really? Cool. Helsinki is pretty gorgeous.
Yeah, very, very pristine.
Yeah. Yeah, except for the young people throwing up on the sidewalk. But other than that, it's very pristine.
I don't know about that.
Oh, yeah. When I went, it was like, you know, I was out at night and stuff. And it was just definitely pristine and beautiful, it was just like, a lot of partying, young people throwing up everywhere.
Oh, that's too bad. I missed that part.
So you did probably an equal amount of studio work, right, as performance, would you say? Or?
Oh, yeah. I was always recording. And I would go from one session to the next and the next.
Those were the days, right? I mean, there was a lot of work in the old days.
Remember those days? And Bonnie introduced me to Michael McDonald.
Mm.
We sounded so good together. You know how some places just sound so
good.
And so I learned how to be a contractor.
Oh.
And fill out the forms from the union.
Cool.
And so I started getting triple scale because he was getting triple scale. And I did the, you know what I mean? And it was like, we got on all kinds of records, you know, and the way that I got in the union, I did a session with Etta James and Bonnie Raitt.
Yeah.
And we were all signed to labels. So we had to call ourselves a name. We couldn't use our names, but it was, I can't remember his name. Anyway, so I'll have to spell it. Fugowe. We were the Fugowe sisters. And how? Etta James, really, I just loved her so much. She was so funny. She came in. And she had gone to get some coffee, and she put all these plastic utensils in her hair, like forks and knives and all kinds of stuff. She had like pink fuzzy slippers on, and she didn't know how to blend for harmony. So we had to put her way in the back and put a bunch of baffles on. song because her voice was so loud.
Wow.
And Bonnie and I, we were just laughing. We were having the greatest time. And so anyway, after that session, Etta takes me, puts her arm around me, and she goes, I'm going to show you something. So we go outside to the, you know, the hall, and all these session singers are there, you know, coming out of a session. They go, oh my God, it's Etta James. I love you. She goes, you girls, you got to start hiring this girl. She can really sing. And I went, well, thank you. Hello. So then when I was on tour, you know, the people who were the big contractors and stuff, I made sure they got tickets to meet James Taylor and Russell and Mick Jackson and all that stuff. And then I started, when I was on tour, I would, if I had a day off, I would fly to like Chicago and do a commercial.
Oh, wow.
Or wherever I was, it was in New York or whatever.
Yeah.
And the union, I was a union rep for a while.
Oh.
Process and stuff.
Yeah.
I never knew I could do stuff like that. And I would, you know, I hired a 100-piece choir for Neil Young.
Wow.
For Living with War. And wow, that was like overnight or something. I was calling people at 4 o'clock in the morning. Can you be at the studio? We got them all. We got 100 people. There's some other people helping too. And, Neil Young's voice is quirky, right?
Yeah.
You try to get 100 people to sing just like it. Whoa, that was hard. Well, that's phrasing the song, you know, and then that falsetto. And, but we did it, and we did 12 songs in 10 hours or something, and without any chairs.
Wow.
That's pretty rough, huh?
That's a long damn time to be standing.
All these things, complete album.
Yeah.
So, I mean, yeah, I've just had
that actually in itself is amazing, actually. 100, I mean, for you to actually call,
overnight.
Get together. Yeah, overnight. Wow. And have it turn out successful. I mean, that's huge.
I knew who the singers were. I knew what they sang, you know, what part and all that.
Oh, and Deborah was there? Deborah Pearl?
There, yeah, yeah.
Okay. Oh, cool, Deb. Wow.
Deb and I have a choir. It's been together how long, Debbie?
there's a little delay, so she might answer. Up, and we all blended. It was miraculous. She'll probably
how long
answer.
Has the National Enquirer been together?
she'll tell soon. Right. 43 years.
43 years. She conducts. And
the choir that you created is still going?
Still going.
And what does the choir do?
Only charity work at Christmas time, singing Christmas carols. We go to a lot of hospitals. We go to
in LA, right?
Yeah.
I think I've heard of it, but I somehow never got there. Interesting.
The LA Mission, yeah, sometimes the homeless people come out and help.
What is the name of the choir?
The National Enquirer. Get it?
I get it.
Santa Claus have a fake nose. I mean, does Santa Claus have cellulite? You know, does reindeer have a fake nose? I mean, you know, it's that kind of, you know,
yeah, yeah.
Very much a rock and roll choir. It's loose. Loosey goosey, but it's really fun and it makes you feel so wonderful.
So being at Christmas time, do you sing Christmas songs?
Yes, we do a few Jewish songs and some songs in Spanish.
But in a rock and roll style or something?
Well, it's rock and roll singers, you know, it's not a chapel or anything like that. You know, it's not formal. Probably most of them don't read, you know. But yeah, we have a blast.
By the way, I'm curious, do you read?
Yeah.
Okay, so that was part of, because I've talked to so many background singers and studio singers who don't read, and they always say the producer always sings you the part, so you have to be good at like grasping it and repeating it.
Yeah, without a first note to get your pitch. That's what happens with David Foster.
Oh, really?
You're supposed to have a perfect pitch. He doesn't even give you like the first note, you know, and you're like,
really? Oh my gosh.
The trick to that is sing softer than everybody else.
Wow, that's interesting.
But I went to Valley College and I went to Santa Monica College.
Oh, interesting. Very interesting.
Very hard.
Yeah.
Piano. I play some piano and I was a bass player. And I play guitar.
Oh, really? Oh, pretty cool. Do you write?
I write. I haven't written for a while, but I have, you know, some songs that I've recorded on some of my albums, and Nicolette Larson did a cover of one of my songs. I had one song in a movie in Japan.
Oh.
With Keith Emerson, and I like to co-write.
Yeah.
I'm more of a lyricist and sing melodies.
Yeah. Yeah. So Arto says he wants to know about the band Bertha.
Oh, okay. Well, you know, Bertha was my guitar player was my best friend since I was 12. Shelly Pinzano, and the drummer, Olivia Favella. She's a wild, wild woman. And she played barefoot and just very petite. And our keyboard player, Shara Taylor. And
was this your first band? Was that it, Bertha?
Well, there was the Ladybirds before that.
Oh, okay, okay.
Ladybirds, named after Ladybird Johnson. Oh, is that a square? That's so Orange County. But the Beatles used to call their girlfriends birds. So we
thought, okay, okay.
You know. Everybody kept getting married and having children and, you know, dropping out and stuff. I just kept going. And so we were together. We were signed to Capitol. No, not Capitol. We were born ABC Dunhill. ABC Dunhill.
Okay, okay.
And one of our singles was Dirty Work. I'm a fool to do your dirty work. Oh, yeah. You know, which...
Wait, excuse me, I'm going to interrupt you. A friend had a technical suggestion. She said there's your mic could be a little louder, and there's a little white noise under your speaking.
My air conditioner, let me turn it off.
Yeah, that's probably it.
White noise.
You don't want her dying though, while dying of heat. I think so.
Oh, good. Good ear. Yeah. Okay, do you want me to be louder still? I can turn it up even more. How's that?
And do you have original sound on Zoom?
It's going through the computer, yeah.
But on Zoom it says original sound off or on.
Oh.
Do you know about that?
I didn't push anything.
Okay, well, it's fine.
I have a monitor. you know, mixer and everything, but
It's better. Thank you.
Okay, good.
So you were talking about Bertha.
Yes, Bertha. And, you know, we, that's the band that opened for B.B. King.
Oh, okay.
Europe. And it was so fun. We're with these incredible musicians, this white girl band, and the audiences were mostly African American, you know? So it was like, what are we doing here? But they were always, you know, they had all these cameras and they were smoking all these cigars and stuff. And in the back, BB had a battery operated record player, which was so incredibly state of the art. And he would play all these old blues, you know, songs that were some of the first ones that were recorded. And the bus driver wouldn't turn the light off because he didn't want any hanky-panky to happen. They were very nice. They were very sweet. And I would always, I loved BB, and I would stand, you know, like behind the curtain like this and watch his show. And he would make me cry.
Oh.
I was so moved. And then when he saw me crying, he'd go, gotcha.
But it's really sweet.
Yeah, we had Three Dog Night, a tour of Europe when we first started, you know.
This group must have been really good to get all these tours. And by the way, Ardo wants to know where the name came from, Bertha.
Bertha? It's like birth is a woman's job, right? You know, the birth of something. It's a girl's name. We had a very big guitar player. She, Bertha. So we stuck, you know.
Wait, that's kind of incredible that you had these two bands. I mean, even from high school with the Rolling Stones, I mean, you know, and then Bertha on the road with people. That's kind of impressive, I think.
We were very, very lucky.
Yeah.
It was thrilling to get an encore from our first, you know, African-American.
Yeah.
Audience, and we're like, what? Okay. And so then when we had Three Dog Night, I think they were first. And I didn't know what the hell was going on, you know. It's so funny. I remember when we signed to the label, the guy who was doing the press, he goes, oh, so I'd like to write a really nice press release for you, you know, because we didn't have that much experience. Mm. What are you gonna say? So he goes, I'd like to kiss you so I could tell people what it was like. Okay.
Oh boy, I have stories like that too. Okay, yeah.
Clueless I was, you know, it was like, oh, is that what we do? Yeah, so anyway, we're on the road this is a cautionary tale for people who are innocent and going on the road with a bunch of rock stars, okay? You just don't know what you're getting into. Orange County, you know, so they go, oh, let's go get a drink afterwards. We're in Germany.
Yeah.
I don't speak German. They don't speak, you know. Right. We don't know where we are. We don't know what we're doing.
Yeah.
Tomorrow morning, right? So we're like in a taxi, and the guy, I guess there was like a row of American hotels. So we're so clueless, we don't write down the name of the hotel, and it's not on our key.
Oh boy.
We don't have the address or telephone number.
Oh boy.
We go to this bar. And they say, oh, you have to drink schnapps and beer. And we're like, ew. You know, I'm used to like something fruity or something. Anyway, so we get plowed. And, you know, this is like, I didn't used to like go and get drunk. I'm not a drunk, I'm not an alcoholic, but I was trying to be hip and be with the rock stars and all this stuff. And they were three sheets to the wind. So luckily we got in a cab, and not one of us could speak the language. And so we're going, oh, well, it's on the corner of Schlupp and Puff of Puff. And Slap and Tissue, yeah, I can hear something. Completely. And so for about, you know, an hour or so, we just went around where the American hotels were. It's somebody got sober enough to call the manager. So we go into the hotel. We get in the elevator, and I guess I shouldn't name any names, but one person passes out in the elevator.
Uh-oh.
And he's like 6'5".
Uh-oh.
So we're going, oh boy, what do? We can't call anybody. You know, we're like, we are just so messed up. So we're like dragging him by hands and feet down the hall. We're just laughing so hard. Guess whose room is the closest room that we came
Yours.
To? So we get him up on the bed, and we're like, you know, throwing water on him and shaking him and doing all this stuff. I think we had just come back from Switzerland or something, and we were like, we had the Swiss bells we were running. He wasn't moving. And we thought, oh God. I said, look, I am not going to be here when he wakes up, okay? I'm not be anywhere near this guy when he wakes up. So I went and slept with my keyboard player, Sherry. And but it was like, you think these people are grownups, and you think that they're going to take care of you and you'll be okay, even though you're in a foreign country, but you have to take care of you.
That was the lesson.
But anyway, do I have any more of those kind of funny? I mean, they're just funny.
I have a little interruption. Well, first of all, Neil Van Eerd, greetings from Gotham, and Mike Campbell.
Hi, Campbell.
Loved you. What a great singer. I miss seeing you at the gym.
Yes, we always saw each other at the gym.
And Dan Davila said he's curious if you ever sang with Lamont Van Hook.
Yes, I did.
He's a great backup singer too. Yeah.
Thank you guys. It's so cool. You have to come to my gig.
Yes, she's having a gig at Vitello's July 30th. Correct?
Yes.
It's probably up on the web already to buy tickets. And tell us about what the gig is going to be.
Oh, okay. I have my set list over here. some Linda Ronstadt, some Little Feet, some James.
And you told me that it was, you were singing the songs that you performed and that became famous.
Right. A lot of them I sang on the records too.
Yeah.
And some of them I just sang like, you know, 10 or 15 years, something that had the hit or something. But yeah, there's some songs from my album. And Tina Turner, What's Love Got to Do with It? It was really fun to start doing this again. I mean, I sang on Looking for Love in All the Wrong
All the Wrong Places. Yeah.
And, you know, but there's, I can tell you all the songs. Adios, Back in the USA, Blue Bayou, Desperado, Dixie Chicken, How Sweet It Is, I Want You to Think of Me, which is from my album. My Baby Thinks He's a Train. I don't know if I'm doing that one. It's Roseanne Cash.
Okay.
Poor, Pitiful Me. Rock and Roll Never Forgets, Bob Seger. Runaway, Running on Empty, Somewhere Out There. You know, that wonderful duet that she did with James Ingram. Interesting story about that. I'll come back. Taking It to the Streets, Travel My Love, What's Love Got to Do with It, What a Fool Believes. You know.
Wow, so many. I just telling Arto, I'm going to write you the name of Vitello's, but they usually have a live streaming choice. So, I have no idea what time it might be where you are, you know, on the gig, probably. I don't know your schedule, but anyway, Vitello's, it's called Vitello's. I'm writing it down. And usually has a live streaming choice.
It's on Tahunga, right?
Yes, it is. Mm-hmm. In Studio City.
And yeah, there might be a live stream. I don't know if there will be, but there's a bunch of videos you have to check out. My Journey, which is my video compilation. Yeah.
Let's look a little bit at that, because it would be kind of fun at this moment. Where am I? Video. Is this it? Yeah.
YouTube channel.
This one, right?
Yeah.
We could watch. I'll just jump around a little bit, you know, because it's 10 minutes long, so.
Started singing mostly in high school, and I was in an all-girl band and played bass guitar and wrote songs. And when everyone else went to the prom, we opened for the Rolling Stones. We did some records for ABC Dunhill, and we did concert tours, kind of a southern boogie rock and roll. We weren't the perfect pretty ones, we were the sweaty kind of wilder ones.
Wow, you sounded great back then too.
We toured with B.B. King and Three Dog Night and The Who. In my travels, I met Bonnie Raitt. We got along really great, and she wanted me to sing on her record. And she actually was the one that really changed my life. I sang on a bunch of her records, actually, and did a lot of live gigs with her. This one is from Russia. It was when people walked across the United States, and then they walked across Russia for peace. And it was kind of a first-time thing.
Oh, I've seen fire, I've seen rain. I've seen sunny days that I thought would never end. How sweet it is to be loved by you. But I needed the shelter of someone's arms. Darling, yes.
Semyas, Moy Druk, Bonnie Raitt.
This is the first time a woman has done this in the Soviet Union. This was a really fun gig because it was kind of a celebration of no war and peace and kind of thing. when I first met Jackson, I didn't know he was a recording star, and I didn't know he was famous. I had been on the road, and I didn't know what was going on. And he couldn't hit this note, and I had been studying voice, so I said, you know, a couple of little things. And he was able to hit the note, and he remembered that. And then Bonnie kind of went, you know, would you take her on tour? And I told him, I said, you know, if you're putting on a tambourine part at 4 o'clock in the morning and no one's there and you'd like someone to clap, you should call me. And so he did, and I clapped and I got the tour. A lot of the contacts and tours and things that I got by doing charity work, like the No Nukes film. I just kind of volunteered my services as a background singer to anyone who wanted somebody to do it. And I met James Taylor, oh, just scads of people, and ended up doing tours and records and stuff from it.
Oh, I love this song.
This was actually one of the first songs I ever sang with James. It was just really fun, and it was really scary. It was also really a rush to do this live a cappella on TV.
Don't turn your head back over your shoulder. Yourself when the silver moon is shining high above the tree.
The very first record that I ever bought was a Johnny Mathis record. And I was really, really thrilled to get to sing with Johnny Mathis.
It's the most wonderful time of the year. There'll be parties for hosting, marshmallows for toasting, and caroling out in the snow. There'll be scary ghost stories and tales of the glories of Christmases long, long ago.
There's another of these TV things with a good dress.
Silver Anniversary Edition. Grammys in 64 categories.
Ladies and gentlemen,
Linda Ronstadt. Get closer. One love. Get closer.
Joe Cocker.
Jay Mahon.
like certain times that it just kind of blew my mind when I got to sing with certain people. I was called to put together a choir for a Kenny Loggins to back him up at the Hollywood Bowl for Earth Day. And so I got about 70 of my friends together. And then I found out that Paul McCartney was going to be the headline. And I went, oh, God. Because since I was 12, I wanted to meet Paul McCartney. And I played left-handed bass, and I was totally a Beatle freak. So I talked to Peter Asher and said, you know, we got this choir. Don't you think we could go na, 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 na at the end? I think we could do that. And so he talked to Paul, and we got to do it. And it was really a thrill. Standing by the park swing.
Rosemary Butler.
Singing is about joy and about giving and about part of our spirituality. When I first thought about singing with people and stuff, I had this calendar from Electrosylum, and it had pictures of all their artists on it. I ended up singing with all of them. So anything that you're visualizing now, that you're thinking you'd like to do, it can happen. It can really, really happen. I believe it can, and I really do.
Oh, wow. Well, I watched the whole thing because it was just, it was great. that was really a good video.
Thank you.
Covered so many beautiful things. Wow. One thing I'm sure there's a bunch of comments here, but it seems like a very strong community, the background singers.
Yeah, you know it is.
Yeah. Was there a noticeable competition or not?
Oh, sure. Everybody wants that gig, you know?
Yeah.
But I didn't pay attention to that, you know. You know, when someone wants what you have or whatever, then that's what, when they're alerted to, that's what they want to do or something like that. That's good. That's called inspiration rather than jealousy.
Yes, I agree with that. That's really good. I had asked you this earlier, but I just thought it was a good question, and maybe people wondered about this. I asked you how the transition from background singing to solo artist was, and did you find any difficult? You said no, you didn't find it difficult at all, but yeah, I'm sure people wonder about that, you know?
Well, it was something that I was always asked, why are you singing background? You should be singing lead, you know? And it just happened. These opportunities came. I couldn't have planned any of it, you know? It wasn't, yeah. I went, oh, I'm going to sing with blah, blah, blah. You know, I couldn't, that was just from the universe, you know? I just happened to be ready and ready to go. I didn't get married. I didn't have children. You know, I remember when I was in high school, some adventure guy came and gave a little talk, and he was talking about the world, and I just went, that's what I want to do. I want to see the world. I want to make sure all the four squares are, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to see the world very much. I had really bad wanderlust.
Yeah. Well, you certainly did see the world, huh? What was one of your favorite places that you went?
I loved Switzerland. It was just so clean, and all those mountains. And
yeah, the mountains.
Lake Geneva, and it just seemed so idealist, you know. that was beautiful. Of course, I loved Japan because I had a couple, you know, record deals there. I had a couple gold records.
I love Japan too.
To love it.
Yeah, I'm very drawn to it. It's like my second home or something, you know.
Yeah, I went there like six times or something, and I just really connected with them as a people.
Yeah.
I was not in all the other countries for very long, so. Let me see. That's one of the most beautiful places. Brazil is pretty outrageous too. When we did Rock and Rio,
yeah,
and it was the first like big concert that they'd ever done. So it was sort of like their Woodstock or something.
Oh,
everybody didn't have cars, so they all went in these buses. We flew in a helicopter, but the helicopters didn't go at night, so we had to take a bus out. And oh my God, they hadn't planned this very well. So there was one street in and one street out, and that's it. So we were stuck there till 6 a.m. in the morning. All the buses that are the same color, and all their exhaust going and everything. And we're like, wow, we got to get out of this bus and take a little walk. But then we thought, how will we find our bus again? All look exactly the same. So we're like holding hands like this, walking, trying to get a glass of water or something, you know. Bathrooms, there was nothing. It was just like, whoa. And when the audience saw James, they treated him like he was the Pope. When we got there, they were just like mobbing him, and because, you know, his rhythmic guitar kind of thing, they love that. And they would stand around his balcony door and stuff, and he'd open the curtains and go, ah, what is he supposed to say?
I guess that's why he developed a love for Brazilian music.
Oh yeah, I think he had it in his soul.
Yeah.
We also went to Jerusalem and Bethlehem.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that was fun. when we got there, you know, the record company said there had been a lot of violence and they didn't want to go with us as a tour guide, but if we wanted to go by ourselves, we could go.
Yeah. Oh.
So we went, yeah, we want to go. So, you know, you have to wear long sleeves and a long dress and a high collar.
Oh, yeah, God.
Scarf on your head and everything. So I'm like, you know, everybody has a different religion or whatever, however they grew up. They're all there, you know. I'm sorry. You know, and so like a living Bible, you know, or something. Yeah. You're just like, oh, my God, this is the Via Dolorosa. You know, or this is, you know, where they stomped the grapes, you know, this is where the cross was to be. But now it's a Muslim bus station. What? We saw the big thing, the big stone that was rolled away, you know.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
Right there. Oh, yeah. God. Lost the presence, for sure. We went to Bethlehem, too. When you go to Bethlehem, you have to humble yourself. It's this big, giant barn. You have to humble yourself and walk through a very small door in order to get in.
Oh.
And, it was astounding. It was just astounding because it really clicked for me that was the real thing. And this was not a Disney movie or something. You know, what do we have to compare that to except for faith? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I was walking to there's four religions in this one church.
Yeah.
And I was walking and there was a muezzin, you know, with the guy singing, you know. Yeah, I can't even imitate it. It was so haunting. It just made my blood turn white, you know. It was like... this is so real, you know. Like everybody suddenly got down on the floor and started, you know, bowing. Oh, wow. Whatever. I was like, wow. And it was just so an ancient city and It was the thrill of a lifetime, really. If anybody gets to go there, they should go, you know, to visit it, because it's not Disneyland and there's no buy your glow in the dark crucifix.
Right.
You know,
kind of brings to mind cigarettes from the Rolling Stone, you know.
It's just
let's see, there's a question: if you've ever worked with Carole King, and did you attend or work at Woodstock?
No, I was too young to do that, but I did work with Carole King briefly. I mean, she was always around James, so yeah. I got to sing. What did I sing? And of course, you know, my friend Nicolette Larson died, and they had a big, you know, tribute memorial kind of thing. And that I also sang with Emmy Lou Harris. And yeah, that's when I sang with her. And she's just an incredible writer. Wow. Wow. You know, just wow.
Just wow. Let me say that. Wow.
Just wow. Yeah.
Yeah. And so what about your new, is it a new record that you have? You've been referring to my record. We could hear a cut if you want. Is which one is it?
It's it's called You Just Watch Me.
Oh, and we were thinking of playing I Want You to Think of Me, right?
Yeah, I Want You to Think of Me. That was written by, either one of those is fine, or Travel My Love.
Okay, you tell me.
Travel My Love has Jackson Browne on it, and the guy that I sang harmonies with Jackson, Doug Haywood.
And one of my favorite bass players in the world, Leland Sklar.
Oh yeah.
When I saw him play, I was so blown away. I just couldn't believe what he was doing. He was just unbelievable to me.
Oh, yes. We're so blessed. You know, when he was a child and everybody else was playing sports and football and all, he was like a concert prodigy as a child.
Oh yeah, and didn't he play jazz first? I mean, as kind of a music that he
in training.
Yeah.
He can do anything. He is so.
I think actually I read that he, I think it was him that he showed up at, you know, high school or wherever, and they said, here's a bass. I think that's what I read about him.
Probably an upright bass, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, he's just.
Well, that's that song is so Travel My Love or I Want You to Think of Me. What would you like me to play?
Well, for the getting over the pandemic, I Want You to Think of Me.
All right. So here it is. And I can't wait to hear this. And this came out a while ago, right? Is it 2013?
I think so.
Okay.
When there's trouble all around you, and it never seems to end. When there's nothing to hold on to, and your fears are closing in. When you're falling through the darkness, to a place you've never been, and there isn't any light that you can see. I want you to think of me. When the world around you changes, all the plans that you have made, you can't face another day. Because you're so afraid. When your heart begins to falter and your hope begins to fade, and you become your own way. worst in me. I want you to think of me. I want you to remember when your back is to the wall. As long as there is breath in me, I'll answer when you call. And if I that's just what they do. There ain't nothing strange about it. That's just how we play the game. Here to help each other. Ain't no cause to be. Turn to me, 'cause you know I do the same. And when you're hurting, you know where I'll be. I want you to think of me.
That's beautiful. Very beautiful. Actually, my friend Roland wants to know where he can get it because it doesn't come up on iTunes.
Oh, tell him to email me and I'll get it to him.
Okay. And,
or go to my Facebook, Rosemary, you know, facebook.com/RosemaryButler, and I will, you know, make sure he knows where he can get it.
Okay. He did buy Rose.
Oh. You were the one.
He's good. He does that. He's a good fan, you know. He's also a guitar player, and but he doesn't do it professionally, but he has, you know, he has in the past, and he has, you know a good, you know, a real guitar player when they have a lot of guitars at home. You know,
I have a friend, a student of mine, who has everybody's first demo.
Oh my god, how interesting.
Like, what? How did you get that? You know?
Wow, yeah, that's like a whole research. Wow.
That's incredible. The collection. They don't have those, you know what I mean? Nobody has. Yeah. So I'm a teacher. I teach voice. I'm also a producer. And I co-produced that album.
Oh, cool.
And I really love producing. I produce some of my students. I love to teach. I get a real thrill when somebody learns something that I know that I have given them some information they couldn't get maybe in a book or something, you know. And it's a gene, because, you know, my grandmother and my uncle.
Yeah.
And I also, you know, I'm on Zoom. And
as you are right now.
My teaching is on Zoom. You teach on Zoom?
I do. And I also, I teach, you know, at home, and I teach on Zoom too. Yeah. I don't mind teaching on Zoom, but I find workshops are more effortful on Zoom. I'd much rather have a group of people here that I can see and touch and, you know, yes, you know.
I like the, you know, real person. But, you know, there's some people who, you know, are far away. So, you know, yeah. I just got a call from Switzerland and London, and, you know, you figure out, okay, that means I have to get up at what time?
Yeah.
But I'll do it, you know.
Teaching is really great, though, isn't it? It's really, it's a beautiful thing to teach. And yeah, it's got so many layers of things, you know, that are good for you. It's good for the student. It's good for the world. It's like, you know, what are you I had, of course, last year was a whole different year, but for about 20 years, I had workshop series going on, you know, that in the first at least 10 or 12 years, I probably had like 10 workshops a month, not just me teaching, somebody like you or somebody visiting through, you know, and I would set up gigs and a workshop. So, and in the first group of years, I had a lot of students who came continually, which was fantastic because you get to see all these people. And what's so cool about the workshops with different people is that you and I might see the same thing when we watch a student, but we're going to talk about how to get to the essence differently because we're different people. We've had different experiences. And so I just think it's fascinating. I love watching people teach, and just teaching people is just, it's really fun to get that excitement going and, you know, maybe to get, you know, to be a shrink kind of, right?
Yeah, I mean, because yeah, as a singer, you know, nobody cares if you can do a million scales, but if you can get to your heart and to your emotions, that's what touches people. And so in order, some people are blocked there. They just, you know, oh, you know, I can sing all the notes right. Isn't that enough? You know, it's not, you know. And so people learn to trust that, you know, that I can help them get to that level emotionally. It takes some time. Some people are already there. This one girl, oh my goodness, after every song, she would break down crying. Well, I'm really feeling it. And I said, okay, do you think that James Taylor breaks down crying every time after every song? You would be a wreck. Pull it together. You know what I mean? The concepts that you don't know, well, I know I'm really feeling it, you know.
That's funny because I remember when I was growing up, Vicky Carr used to always break down when she would sing. And somebody at one point said, well, you know, it's like, we don't always really want to hear you break down every time you sing, you know, just move on, you know.
Yeah, I was taught that as a singer, you're supposed to make the audience cry, not you.
Right. Well, but sometimes you can't help it, you know, but you're so correct, right?
You know, that's what I had to learn, because when I was like playing bass and, you know, doing all this Janis Joplin stuff and everything, I physically was bleeding. My hands were bleeding.
Wow.
I didn't physically hurt while I was singing. I wasn't getting deep enough or something. And then
yeah,
the teacher went, babe, you know, it's not masochistic. Okay. It's you're a storyteller. You are telling the story so that they can feel their feelings and they get touched. One time I did this house concert, you know, you never know what the audience is going through, right? I
mean,
his husband might've just died. They might've lost a baby.
Yeah.
Who knows what? But this girl was standing in front of me and she was just weeping. I mean, it was like just weeping. And I didn't know what to do. I mean, I didn't want to go, do you want a tissue or something? You know, I mean, to address it. But so I just took my finger and I wiped her eye and put it on my tongue.
Oh.
Because it was a gift to me.
Oh, that's so sweet.
That's sweet. I mean, that was the nectar of singing, you know.
That's really a sweet gesture. Yeah. Yeah, that's really nice.
With it, you know. I mean, she was really feeling it, and I was too. And yeah, sometimes I've wept and while I'm singing in front of thousands of people, but you know, we have to have feelings too. And I also never knew, as a background singer, how to get the audience's love. I thought, oh, it's all for James Taylor. It's all for Linda, you know? And then I would be like devastated when I'd get off the stage. Oh, you know? And then I had to learn to receive that love from the audience so that I could have some energy to go to the next audience and the next audience and the next audience, you know what I mean?
Yeah, interesting.
It's like a self-esteem thing.
Yeah.
I'm working hard. Yeah.
Yeah, there's so much. There's so many layers to what we do. Yeah, it's crazy. Whoa.
You also have to like bring your ego down and not pull focus, and it's almost like you have to, like with Linda, I mean, it's like you are Linda, you know, doing everything, you know, with her accent, with her tone, with her vibrato, everything is, and that's a work of art, just to be able to do that. And then you develop your own style, which my friend Peter Asher said, you know, what gets you signed is having an immediately identifiable sound. You don't sound just like anybody.
Yeah.
Whether, you know, whatever that is, you know. I once had a student come in and he sang backwards like this. I invented this new technique. And I went, oh my God, you don't know what you're doing to your voice. You're gonna end up in the hospital. But he said, yeah, but it's, nobody's ever done it. And I went, there's a reason.
I have heard that before. That I have heard that from a student. I wonder if it was the same person. That's kind of crazy, isn't it? It's like, well, yeah, you're right. You don't hear that sound. That's true. And there's a reason.
I mean, Boss Gags kind of sings back like that.
Yeah.
And Kermit, you know, but
yeah,
that I don't think it's very healthy for your voice. It's hard to find something that moves you. It's the material too. I think you can be the greatest singer in the world and not have the right material. And you have to know, like when I taught at UCLA Extension, I taught finding your vocal identity.
Yeah.
Which is, you know, what is your point of view? Are you a victim? Are you, you know, a survivor? Are you, you know, what is your point of view? What is your personality like? What, you know, what do you like to talk about? I mean, are you always singing the blues or, you know, what runs through your veins, you know, what makes you, your personality, you know, not only your personality, but your heart, you know, what does your heart feel, you know? And, it's a singer's quest to find their own authentic voice and, you know, picking those songs that are so, Linda was great at picking songs for herself. Just masterful.
Yeah. The other thing that I think is a singer's quest, not only singers, for all musicians, is to get to that magic universe as quickly as possible and stay there till the end of the song. Right. You know, and I talk about that with students a lot because, you know, they have problems with that. You know, they, you know, it's the background talking and, you know, the lack of confidence and lack of experience, which is difficult to get these days, you know, in live performance, you know, especially when you're older, you know, like when you're younger, you might have people in college, you know, to work with and mess around with. And there's a community of that, you know. But yeah, so that's another thing about getting to the magic right away. Did you ever talk about that with your students?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I mean, I've already taught them a bunch. I have Arnold McCullough has a CD out.
Yeah, I have that. It's beautiful.
Yeah, and I'm one of the guests.
Oh, cool. Now I know even more. Yeah.
But once they know some basic warm-ups and they, you know, we have a plan for them, what they're working on, and if they're working on a, you know, recording or a, you know, whatever they're working on, I want them to come in the door with the magic.
Mm.
You know, I want them to be confident. I want them to be in character. I want them to, like, if you go for an audition.
Yeah.
The minute you open the door, you're on stage, you know, you're on film, you know. You don't just stand there and go, now what was I supposed to do? You know, you have to own it. So it means a lot of repetition, a ton of repetition. And then you get out of the safe place and into the place where you're raw and you're willing to take a chance and a leap or whatever it is that you do. And you don't know if you're going to land sometimes, but that's why you rehearse. Once you find your place where you break it and you go into your own little space with it, right or wrong. I was trying to do Mind Gorillas by John Lennon, you know, and I was like, really? I don't know millions and millions of Mind Gorillas. This is not a song I should sing. It's just too abstract for me. I can't deal with it, you know. Like, what? I can't do that song. Like, Barbara Streisand can't get funky. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's just not going to rock out.
Yeah.
It's just not part of who she is, you know?
Yeah.
So I asked them to get some feedback from their friends that described to them what your voice sounded like.
Mm.
You know, a bunch of their friends say, oh, you're country rock, or you're, you know, soft, or you're a screamer, or you're, you know, very rhythmical, or, you know, whatever it is. Because sometimes we can't see our own face, you know?
Yeah.
And we need feedback. And that happens when you do a lot of recording and you have all these, you know, people telling you what to do. Okay, I want you to do this, I want you to do that, you know? And then you put them all together, kind of pick and choose from what they taught you, you know, to get the job done. Oh, toilet paper. Yes. Let's sing about that with feeling, you know.
Oh, gosh. Yeah. I remember when I was younger here working, you know, as a jazz singer, my girlfriend was becoming a very well-known studio singer. And one time she said to me, you're really lucky because you know who your voice is, you know, you know who you are. And I don't. And I was like, oh, okay, well, yeah, there, whatever the choices we make, you know, we go through and for whatever reasons.
Yeah. If it doesn't sound anything like your speaking voice, then it's probably not right.
So true. Right.
You have a beautiful speaking voice.
Thank you. So do you. Oh, I noticed that earlier. Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's like we can all try different hats on, and, you know, some of them just look terrible, you know. It's constantly, you know, changing, and you constantly have to find something new to do. You can't just do the same thing all the time, you know. You have to pull out of it and find some fresh space for you to stretch out, you know.
Yeah.
So but the songs, you know, make a huge difference.
Really do. Along this year, I met, I don't know if you know him, Mark Jordan.
Well, that sounds familiar.
M-A-R-C. He's from Canada, and he wrote for Rod Stewart, but he also wrote for the Manhattan Transfer, and his songs are very reminiscent to me of Bonnie's. Okay. But he's a really interesting singer. He plays guitar too. He's, to me, he phrases like a jazz singer, but he's singing that style of like Bonnie Raitt stuff. So, and he's such a great writer. You should check him out. Oh my God.
What's his name?
Mark, M-A-R-C, Jordan.
Mark Jordan from Canada?
Yeah. Oh my God. You'll love his songs. They're very kind of Bonnie Raitt-ish, you know, and just, wow, he's just a great writer.
Cool. Very cool. It sounds like I've met him before, but I'm...
Yeah, he's, you know, in our general age bracket too. By the way, my friend Roland, who bought your record, he's coming to see you at Vitello's. He bought tickets.
Yay! Excellent! Guys, thank you for having me here. And be sure to come up and say hi, and you know, I'll sign it if you want me to or whatever. Get out my lipstick and, you know.
He'll love that. He has a bald head. Maybe you could kiss his
head. Yeah, sure. Absolutely. It's the least I can do. I got to sing with Joni Mitchell.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
Wow.
Fun. Because she was always around James. And we did You Are My Only One. And I think it was, what's his name? Don Henley, too. But anyway, she was my idol. And, you know, she does everything. She does the cover. She does the arrangements. She plays all the instruments. She sings all the harmonies. And to sing harmony with Joni, now that was like my dream. So one time I was like singing with Bonnie, and I had a little cassette player. And I'm running over my part, which was the high part, on in the dressing room. And she opens the door and she sings the whole song with me, the low part, without saying, "Oh, hi, I'm Joni," or whatever. I went, "I know who you are. I love you." I love her songs. They're so ancient. I mean, God, the colors and all the stuff that's in there. So glad that she's still with us, you know.
I remember when her orchestrated song, you know, recording came out that Vince Mendoza arranged, you know, with Both Sides Now and a Taste of You. And I didn't know who it was, actually, because I thought it sounded like an older Black woman, right? Because I hadn't heard her sing in years. Her voice changed so dramatically. Then I, you know, then the songs, A Case of You, probably maybe one of my all-time favorite songs ever. And then Both Sides Now, from where she was at. Yeah. I was a total weeping rag.
For her, yeah, absolutely. And you know, the first time I met Linda, I was sitting in a living room and we were both sitting on chairs and she was singing and I was supposed to come up with a harmony or something. And I couldn't even breathe. It was the loudest voice I ever heard and it was so in tune. It was the majestic voice. It was just like a train came through the room or something.
Wow.
She's such a power belter, you know. I was like, God, I better study, you know. Get busy or I'm gonna be run over. And very generous. And you know, when she would do the duets with Aaron Neville, she would let me do the sound checks.
Wow, cool.
She also let me lead the orchestra. And so did Bette Midler. And that was really a trip, because you're so used to having the drummer. And when you sing with an orchestra, if you hold out a note, the whole orchestra is holding out the note. You know, the director is waiting for you to change. And it's like, help! I don't want to get back. You do get back, but I mean, it's like, you can't rest on it. You know, you can't find the groove back here. You know, it's like,
yeah,
just a living organism, you know?
Yeah.
And I sang on The Rose many years ago. And I met Bette at a birthday party for Graham Nash. It was at the Madonna Inn. Have you ever been to the Madonna Inn?
Yes. That's one of California's special places.
Oh my God. Red, white, and blue roses on the wallpaper. And I think Lee Sklar had like an antique car as his bed or something. You know, such an interesting place. But anyway, I met her there, and she goes, oh, I love vocal coaches. You know, and I went, yeah. And I was like, what do I teach her? But you know, it's like, I always had so much respect for her because she's so hilarious. And then I gave her a bunch of lessons, and she had me come to New York. Mm. And I taught her there. And then she said, I'm going to be doing a record on Rosemary Clooney songs. Huh. And Rosemary Clooney died. And Rosemary Clooney was Linda Ronstadt's musical mother.
Oh.
See, the stars fall into, you know, a special place when certain things happen. And when Linda went from rock and roll to
Broadway or something.
Yeah, she went to Broadway too, but she also went to opera. But she went to the jazz stuff, and you know, she had Rosemary Clooney as and so she fed her all of her audience. And Nelson Riddle, I mean, come on,
yeah,
what are the chances of that? But you know, it feels good to an older artist to be able to give that to somebody that can really do something about that, you know. That's when I call it the stars align, you know. Okay, we're going to bless you now.
Yeah, a lot of blessings on her, huh?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
She was fearless as far as style goes, because no matter what style she did, we knew it was her in 2 seconds flat.
Yeah, yeah.
That voice is unmistakable. One in a million.
Yeah. Rosemary Clooney actually was one of my... I guess, musical mentors when I was growing up. You know, there was Ella Fitzgerald, Rosemary Clooney. I definitely learned some phrasing from her. You know, she wasn't fancy schmancy. Ella was the improviser, you know, but.
You're so good at that. Oh my God, you're so good at that.
Thanks. You're
really a great instrumentalist.
Oh, thank you. But Rosemary was just, wow, what a beautiful sound. And you know, the thing that I admire a lot, and you mentioned some of it, and I just had a friend here from the East Coast who's an amazing singer named Paul Jost. And he came and he did a few concerts, one at Vitello's and a workshop. But at Vitello's, I mean, you would love him. He's all in. He's not, you know what I mean? He is in with every fiber of his body. He's done the work. He knows who he is. He's got the ears and the heart and respect for the band. The band has respect for him. He has respect for the audience. I mean, it's just everything. And watching a singer like that is just... I don't know. It's great. You trust the performer enough to absolutely open up wide as the audience and receive. And it changes you. It changes your DNA. It changes your soul. It changes your body, you know?
Oh, I know. Even if you're in the grocery store getting something out of the freezer and you hear Dan Fogelberg and you start crying, you know? Like, what? I didn't see that coming. You know? Aerial systems they have in these grocery stores.
Oh my God. Hey, well, it's almost 2 hours.
You're recording this. It's going to be.
I am. I'm recording it. I will have it in my archives, and it will also be living on Facebook and YouTube. You know, so you can. But I'll share it with you as well. Thanks. And I just want to say thank you so much for sharing your time, your precious time and your
and yours. Yeah.
You're just, I mean, it's really fun to talk to you and to hear everything. And
oh, well, you know, thank you. I appreciate it. And, you know, it's a really wonderful thing because you're telling people about this and they can come to my gig, which is on the 5th of July.
Yeah.
And they
Patello's. Yep. July 30th. Gosh. Dan, you said you're going to Vitello's, but you know what, Dan? You bought a ticket to Catalina's on that date. So, see, yeah, he wants to come too, but he bought tickets for he and I to go to Catalina's. So, if he actually didn't, then we'll be at your show.
Oh, okay.
But Roland will be at your show.
Okay. Roland?
Yes, Roland. Yes.
Come and say hi.
You will, I'm sure, right, Roland? Yes. So, boy, thank you so much. People listening, tomorrow I was supposed to have an old friend of mine on, Brad Hatfield, but I really have had trouble reaching him, and I'm kind of worried about him, actually, because I mean, he hasn't sent me back a reply and said, I can't do it or whatever. So I don't know. Maybe it might be the Cathy Segal-Garcia show, which sometimes I come on and play people and talk and get comments from the audience and stuff. And then Wednesday, my friend and a lot of yours out there, Alan Walker, who's a raconteur kind of, you know, guy. And he has a lot of great stories. He's a tenor sax player mostly. And a great, great guy. And then Thursday through Sunday, we have the archives, Andrea Wolper and Ken Filiano, Cathy Segal-Garcia again, Les Demurl, drummer, and Calabria Foti, who's just an amazing singer and violinist. So those are the archives. But we keep going. Oh yeah, one more thing. Sorry, a little promotion for me. Saturday night, the 17th, I have this gig twice a month that happens, the first and third Saturdays of every month at a place called the Conference Room in Playa Vista. And it's, I sing the first set and then I open it up for jam. And so instrumental singers, and it's really fun. And this particular Saturday, I'm having some really great players from out of town be my band, Bob Bowman and Pat Coyle, who they both used to live here, and they played with a lot of people. But anyway, it's going to be quite musical and great. So that's Saturday, the Conference Room. You can find that on my website.
Busy woman.
Yeah, well, yeah. You know, I mean, I don't have to tell you. What else is there? It's like.
It's what we do.
Yeah, man, it's food.
It's food. Food for the soul.
Thank you so much, Rosemary.
Oh, I enjoyed myself. I had such a great time. You know, so funny because my mom always said, don't brag. Okay. But I'm just advertising.
But, you know, it's not exactly bragging. I mean, it's just, it has to do with your attitude about that. You know, it's like, well, yeah, your life has been full of great experiences and, you know, you have a show and you have a, I mean, it's not bragging. It's just being who you are.
That's all. Yeah. Thanks for listening, everybody.
Thank you, Rosemary.
Okay.
Have a great day.
Thank you. You too.
Bye.
Jeff and Gail Turner Graham.
Just in time. Bye.
Bye.